أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على ما لا نبي أبدا سيدنا ونبينا وحبيبنا ومولانا محمد صلى الله تعالى عليه وسلم وعلى آله وصحابه ومن اهتدى بهداه إلى يوم الدين فإن خير الحديث كتاب الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله تعالى عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار ربي اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقهوا قولي ربي لا تؤاخذني مما يقولون واغفر لي ما لا يعلمون واجعلني خيرا مما يظنون أما بعد. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi ta'ala wa barakatuh. Welcome to this beautiful edition of the House of Dua. Welcome to our last episode in our discussion on Zakah, coming to you from our series titled The Right Way to Worship. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, this is about the seventh video, the seventh presentation we are bringing to you on Zakah. We have done so because we want all of us to understand what this third principle of Islam is all about. As I have stated earlier, in my career as a da'i, whenever I speak to people about Islam, I get more questions relating to zakat than any other pillar of Islam. And I'm sure the same thing applies to any other scholar of Islam. The fact is that zakat is a very interesting topic. It is the pillar of Islam which requires us to part with a little portion of our income and give it to somebody who is not so privileged like us. And because of our nature, we love our money, our wealth. We love it so dearly that most of us would not like to part with it. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who created us and brought us to this planet, knows that all of us will not be equal. There are some that are created and they came to this world deficient in some forms of life. Whereas there are others who came in perfectly. They can see, they can walk, they can run, they can think. But there are others who are not so endowed. And there are others who are not fast in business. Allah has endowed us differently at different capabilities. But He wants to make sure that as we live together, we live in harmony and peace. He doesn't want a situation where some will be living good and others are suffering. Therefore, it wants a situation where we can be our brother's keeper, we can help one another out. That is why He has decreed that those of us who are well off should take a little portion of our income to help those who are not so well off, so that there will be an equilibrium in the society. This is the only religion that has this kind of principle, in the sense that it's a decree from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and we are expected to carry it out as an act of worship. Islam is a unique religion, and we should be happy that we are Muslims. But unfortunately, there are people who are not so attracted to this principle of Islam. Why? Because it demands from them that which they so much covet, that which they so much love, and so they don't want to give it out. But if they know the value, if they know what the outcome of their giving it out is going to be for them, the reward involved, of course, they will not hesitate to give it up. Today, therefore, we are using this medium to encourage ourselves to ensure that we discharge our duty of zakat. As I stated, it is the principle of Islam that we talk less about and we do less about. That is not so fair. We have to talk more about it and learn more about it and try to carry it out up to the limit of our ability. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, we have brought you seven episodes on this issue. I need you to go back to each of the episodes and, you know, listen to them. They will help you understand what is involved in the discharge of this third pillar of Islam known as zakat. There are many people who have questions. As I said, it is a subject matter that generates a lot of questions from people. Majority of these questions, from my own experience, are people who truly and genuinely want to discharge the duty of zakat, but they needed more information. Either they were not so informed or they didn't have sufficient knowledge And so they really wanted to ask questions to be on the safe side. Unfortunately, there are questions also from those who are finding ways to evade zakat or to circumvent the process. If you belong to that latter group, I encourage you to think twice. Think twice, because to display some reluctance towards this principle may have a severe consequence on you. There are those who delay paying zakat. To delay the payment of zakat is undesirable. Therefore, if you are in that category, try and stay away from it. Pay the zakat as and when due. There are those who fail to pay zakat. Failure to pay zakat when it is due is a sin. Therefore, don't fail to pay zakat. The other one is refusal to pay zakat. Refusal to pay zakat actually makes you a disbeliever. It takes you away from the realm of Islam into kufr. Refusal to pay zakat is like refusal to have kalma shahada. It's like refusal to do salat. It's like refusal to do the hajj or to fast in the month of Ramadan. There's another category of those who they don't refuse, but they try to evade paying zakat. These are hypocritical about it. Again, it's a very serious sin to do so. Therefore, try as much as possible not to evade zakat. And the Prophet ﷺ will remind you of the great consequence that await those who refuse to pay zakat or evade paying zakat or fail to pay zakat. Therefore, do not fall into any of these categories. We are concluding this episode today with a discussion on the frequently asked questions on zakat. Most of these questions have already been dealt with. We have dealt with them in the various videos that I want you to go back and take a second look. But for the benefit of those of us who still have some questions that we may not have answered, we have decided to come up with a short list of frequently asked questions. There are so many questions in the minds of several people. I can't deceive you about that when it comes to the principle of zakat. But as I said, this is not a forum for us to deal with all those type of questions. Therefore, I'm going to concentrate on those that I think are regularly asked by people and those that I think also are very unique and they need proper clarification. I want you to pay attention, my dear brothers in Islam. We have already discussed the issue of zakat, what it means. It's a third principle of Islam in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala requires those who are rich to give us a tiny portion of their income to help those who are poor, so that everybody in the society will have enough to survive. As simple as that. What is that portion of income that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants us to take out? 2.5% of your net income. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, before you take out the 2.5% of that income, you are expected to attain a certain level known as nisab. Many people always ask, what is nisab? Nisab is the minimum that you are expected to have in order to qualify to pay zakat. If you don't have that minimum within a period of 1 year, you are not qualified to pay zakat. As a matter of fact, you may be qualified to receive. In the previous episode, I referred to it as what is called the poverty line. If you are below the poverty line, you cannot pay zakat. But if you are above it, then you are qualified to pay zakat. Then people often ask, what is my zakatable income? We have explained this as well. Zakatable income is your net income after deduction of all your cost of living expenses, as well as the debts you owe and the fees you pay to every authority that is governing you. Therefore, whatever is left is your zakatable income. If you earn $50,000 in a year, for example, and you have expenses of $40,000 throughout the year for your cost of living, running your family and taking care of your children and your parents and so on, and as well as the debts that you owe, maybe your house rent and maybe your car notes, as the case may be, by the time you deduct all that, what is left for you is $10,000. 2.5% of $10,000 is your zakat, and that is just about $250. The other question that people normally ask is, what about the deductibles? The deductibles are those things you are allowed to deduct from your income before you pay zakat. As I said, your cost of living expenses, the debts that you owe, as well as the care for your parents, as well as the fees you pay to every governing authority in your area, and other essential expenditures that you make like that. Those are the ones that are referred to as the deductibles. You are expected to deduct them from your total gross income you earn in a year before you pay zakat on the net income, which is known as the zakatable income. Once you have taken the zakat out of your income, then the next thing is, who do you give the zakat to? That is the next question. What do we mean by a zakat recipient? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, chapter 9 of the Holy Quran, Surah At-Tawbah, verse 60, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala declared 8 categories of people who are due to receive zakat. Human beings, not the institutions, my dear brothers and sisters in Islam. These are the poor, the needy, those who are in charge of distribution of zakat. And of course, those whose heart is to be reconciled, those who are at the borderline, you know, who may be non-Muslim for now, but they are eager to enter Islam, or who are already into Islam, such people need to be helped with zakat income. The same thing with those who are in bondage, maybe those who are in prison, for example, you know, for genuine reasons, and we can get them out of prison or bondage through zakat. Again, those who are overburdened by debt. In other words, their total indebtedness is far more than what they earn. Therefore, they have no resources to take care of themselves. Such people are expected to be given zakat as well. So also are those who are struggling in the way of Allah, who have gone out to defend Islam, either in the battlefield or in any other capacity similar to that. They are qualified to receive zakat. And so also are those who are stranded. They may be rich in their place of residence, but they travel and got themselves stranded. Such people should be given zakat. These are the 8 categories of people that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says should be given zakat. Another question many people always ask is, can I split my zakat into any of these categories? Yes, if you have enough that you think can go around, you can split your zakat into 2 or more categories to give to those who are supposed to receive it. The other question is, what about giving zakat to somebody in my hometown or whom I think is qualified? Well, transferability of zakat is allowed, provided you ensure, as a matter of first priority, that those who are in your immediate environment where you live are taken care of. But if you so find that the need for it is more in your place of origin or far away places like that, then it's permissible to transfer zakat to another location to pay for it. Is it better for you to pay zakat for yourself or give it to authority to pay for you? My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, it's better for you to pay zakat for yourself than give to a third party to pay for you. But if you are not in a proper position to do it by yourself, then it's permissible for you to give it to somebody to do it for you. The next question is, can we give zakat to non-Muslims? No, zakat is not meant for those who associate partnership with Allah. Zakat is not meant for disbelievers, in short. The only condition, and it's a very special condition, is if it is identified that such people are eager to enter Islam or they're already into Islam, but there is risk of their backsliding back to kufr. Therefore, such people can be given zakat. What about the zakat to the sinner? If you know that somebody who is sinful, if you give him zakat, is going to use the zakat to commit sin, are you supposed to give him zakat like somebody who deals on drugs or alcoholism and so on and so forth? Yes and no. If that zakat will help that person get out of that sin, you are trying to help that person get out of that sinfulness, then of course, it's permissible to do that. But we should not give zakat to somebody whom we know very well is going to use zakat to commit sin. My dear brothers in Islam, when I'm giving out zakat to somebody, do I need to disclose to that person? Of course. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, if you give it out secretly, it's good. If you give it out openly, it's good. But if you give it out secretly, it's better. Therefore, it's encouraged that when you want to give out zakat, you don't necessarily have to announce it ostentatiously, but you can disclose to the person to whom you are giving zakat that this is your zakat. There's no sin about that. Do I give zakat to those who are corrupt or allow those who are corrupt to help me distribute my zakat? The answer is no. If you know somebody who is corrupt, is going to abuse the zakat you are giving to him or her, you do not have to pay zakat through that person. The earlier you avoid that, the better it is. What of money that I get from unlawful sources? Can I use zakat out of it in order to cleanse that money? No. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, you don't use wrong to achieve right in Islam. Allah is pure. He does not like that which is not pure. Therefore, you got to do what is pure. You are only allowed to pay zakat out of your legitimately earned income. What about the case of our sisters? What about their personal belongings like jewelry or dowry and so on and so forth? Yes, those that you are using on a regular basis are not zakatable. But if you are the type of person who buy and hoard them, then of course you have to pay zakat on their value. The same thing if you are paid dowry that is so enormous above the nisab level, then of course you are also required to pay zakat on that. What about the man who receives zakat? What is he supposed to do? If you are paid zakat, somebody comes to you and gives you zakat, you have an obligation to tell that person thank you and to pray for that person. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told the Holy Prophet Muhammad, Fasalli alayhi inna salataka sakanan lahum. Pray for them, for your prayer is a source of tranquility for them. My dear brothers and sisters, what of the most important aspect of this process, which is known as the intention? People always ask questions about this. At what point in time do I make intention? At that point in time when you have taken out the 2.5%, that's when you make your intention to give out zakat. And as we have stated time and time again, according to the hadith narrated by Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu anhu, the Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam said, Innamal a'malu binniyat wa innamal likulli imrin ma nawa. All actions are judged according to the intention behind them. So making intention before we pay zakat is absolutely important. What about zakat for children? Are children allowed to pay zakat? Only and only if they have income by way of inheritance that is above nisab, and they have owned that income over a period of 1 year. To that extent, a child can pay zakat. Otherwise, children are not allowed to pay zakat. Only adult male and female are qualified to pay zakat. What about a situation in which you are not too sure of your income or you are not too sure of your, you know, expenditures? You are allowed to make reasonable guess. But remember, Allah knows your intention more than you. Again, what about an error? If in the course of your trying to pay zakat, you do calculation and you make mistake, who is responsible? Well, genuine mistake, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive. He has assured us in the Quran, Laysa alaykum junah un fima aktatu bi wa lakin ma ta'ammadat qulubukum. Allah will not hold you accountable for what you do by error in his worship, but he will hold you accountable for what you do intentionally. Therefore, if you make mistake in the calculation of your income for zakat or in your deductibles, then of course, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala may forgive you. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive our sins. But there are some people, when they have made up their mind to pay zakat, they want to use that zakat to pay for hajj, for the person who is going to receive the zakat. Or they see the person who is going to receive the zakat is so poor, they themselves go to the market to buy things for that person. Is that permissible? It's not allowed. You are indirectly spending the zakat by yourself. It's better for you to give the zakat to that person. He is in a position to define what is his priority. Maybe his priority is not hajj. Maybe his priority is not clothes. Therefore, you are not allowed to spend the money for the person who is going to receive the zakat. My dear brothers and sisters, there is what we call zakat buyback. People always ask this question as well. It's not allowed for you, the zakat you have given out, to go around and take it back again or buy it back in a different way or demand it back in a different way. What if a situation where you have decided to pay zakat, you have taken out the portion, but as you are about to pay the zakat, something happened, you lost the zakat. Is that a situation where you have to pay again? The answer is no. If you have already taken it out and you are about to deliver it, but something happened, you lost the zakat, you are not liable. But if you kept the zakat unduly, that's why we say you must pay zakat in time. If you continue to keep it unduly and something happened, or you are qualified, you have income that qualifies you to pay zakat upon it, and you didn't pay in time, and you lose that income consequently, am I still liable for the zakat? Of course, you are liable for the zakat. What of the zakat that you have not paid for the past 1 year or 2 years or 3 years? Am I still liable? This is another question that many people always ask. The answer is obviously yes. It's like the salah that you missed. If you miss your salah 20 years ago, and you remember today, you will still have to repeat that salah. You will still have to pay back that salah. The same thing, if you miss zakat 20 years ago, you will still have to pay that zakat. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, what of the zakat of my person who is dead? Let's say my mother or my father. He or she was due to pay zakat, but did not pay that zakat before he or she died. Am I allowed to pay zakat for them? Of course, yes. In such a case, the estate left behind by such dead person, the zakah must be one of the things to be removed after the settlement of debts before every other thing can be calculated and distributed to the inheritors. What of somebody who is dead, my father who is dead long ago, but he doesn't owe zakah? Can I continue to pay zakah on his behalf? The answer is no. There is no zakah on somebody who is dead. Just as the dead person will not come back and do salat, and will not come back to do fasting in the month of Ramadan. Another question that people ask is variation. Variation in income. Some people will say, I attained Nisab at the beginning of the year, but at the middle of the year, my income was not up to Nisab. Or towards the end of the year, I have already spent all my money to the extent that my income does not reach the level of Nisab. In such a case, once you have attained Nisab at a point in time throughout the 12-month calendar, you are qualified to pay zakat. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, whether the income declined from January to February or to December is immaterial. The fact is that you reach the level known as Nisab, and therefore that qualifies you to pay zakat. And what about the new investment portfolios we find in today's economies, which were not there in the time of the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam, such as stocks, 401k, Roth IRA, mutual funds, and other forms of investment that people do nowadays, which were not there in the time of the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. Can we pay zakah on them? Of course, yes, you pay zakah on them. You have to calculate zakah on the market value of such investment, less the fees that you pay on them, and pay zakah on the income that you derive. There are other people who also ask the question about non-Arab-based products that we find in other countries, which were not mentioned in the Quran, such as the produce. You know, for example, like in Africa, people commonly ask, can we pay zakah on yam or pineapple or plantains and so on and so forth? Of course, whatever generates income, you must pay zakah on them. The reason why the products mentioned in the Quran were mentioned is that those were the products available in the time of the Prophet in his place of birth. If the Quran were revealed in Africa, of course, the food in Africa would have been mentioned. The fact that they are not mentioned doesn't mean that they are not zakatable. Therefore, find out the appropriate rules that apply to the African produce and pay zakah on them wherever you are. As I said, there are many other questions that people may ask, which we may not be able to deal with here. But if you have any of such questions, please don't hesitate to reach out to us. We will try as much as possible to answer such questions. And more importantly, I would recommend that you meet the imam in your area so that you will be able to know exactly what you are supposed to do. There are other questions that people may also ask. For example, the difference between zakah and sadaqah. I've already explained this before. Zakah and sadaqah are not the same. They are always similar. But sadaqah is what you give out by yourself at your own determination. At any time you want to do it, in whatever amount you want to do it. It's your own decision you are making. But zakah is a decision of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What to give, who to give it to, when to give it, is determined by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What is expected of you is obedience. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, obedience is the central core of our faith. That's what distinguishes us from those who do not believe. Once you have accepted to be a Muslim, then the next thing is for you to obey all the commandments of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Do not find any reason why you evade the commandment of Allah. In this case, I want to refer to Surah Al-Ahzab, chapter 33 of the Holy Quran, in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَا كَانَ لِمُؤْمِنٍ وَلَا مُؤْمِنَةٍ إِذَا قَضَى اللَّهُ وَرَسُولُهُ أَمْرًا أَن يَكُونَ لَهُمُ الْخِيَرَةُ مِنْ أَمْرِهِمْ وَمَن يَعْصِ اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَهُ فَقَدْ ضَلَّ ضَلَالًا مُبِينًا. My dear brothers and Islam, it is not fitting, it is not appropriate for a Muslim man or woman to have his or her personal opinion or reservation on any matter that had been decided by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and his Prophet Muhammad sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam has conveyed the information to you. It's not allowed for you to vary in your action with respect to that issue. Whoever rebels against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that person has gone away from the path of Islam, far, far away. In Surah Al-Ghafir, which is chapter 40 of the Holy Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Ma yujadilu fi ayatillahi illa allatheena kafaroo fala yaghurruka taqallubuhum fil bilad. There is none who we argue against the command of Allah except those who are disbelievers. Therefore, Any of you who is trying to argue against the payment of zakah, knowing fully well that it's a principle of Islam, you are actually in the realm of kufr. Therefore, be careful. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, no one will argue against his commandment or try to deviate from it, except those who are disbelievers. And you as a believer should not allow the pomp and pageantry of those who disbelieve to beguile you away from the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In other words, be careful. Don't allow yourself to be deceived. In Surah An-Nur, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also stated, Inna ma kana qawla al-mu'minin izadu ila Allahi wa rasuli liyakuma bainahum an yaqulu sami'na wa ata'na. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, what is expected of a believer when a believer is invited to the way of Allah for judgment? What is expected of you as a believer is to say what? Semina watana. We hear and we obey. You continue to equivocate when the message of Allah has been conveyed to you and you begin to find way out of it, you are not behaving as a Muslim. My dear brothers in Islam, I encourage you, as I said, if you have other questions, find out from the imam in your area or reach out to us. We will not hesitate to clarify such questions. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us good Muslims, take shaitan away from our lives, and take our life far away from the shaitan. Rabbana tabamina innaka anta sami'un alim wa tub alayna ya maulana innaka anta al-ghafurur rahim. Subhanallahi wa bihamdihi, subhanaka allahumma wa bihamdika, ashhadu an la ilaha illa anta, astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk. Alhamdulillah.